mobile carbon capture for semi-trucks was thought to be impossible. Until now.
Here we go. Up to 1,000 RPM.
That sound you're hearing is mobile carbon capture in action. The device on the back of the semi-truck is removing 80% of the carbon from its exhaust. And that's a huge deal.
Every year, semi-trucks create 339 million metric tons of CO2. That's 5% of the entire US carbon footprint. But we have to keep these trucks running because they're an essential part of our supply chain. It's just this massive problem, and we don't have a good solution to decarbonize these trucks.
We're building something that's never existed before, and so we have to push ourselves to show people just how far this could go. We have the chance here to make a massive swing in CO2 emissions from positive to negative.
Detroit has given its country a lot, most notably in transportation. The automotive industry started here in 1901. 12 years later, Henry Ford invented the moving assembly line. They laid the first mile of concrete highway, painted the first road lines, and even installed the first modern three-colored traffic light. And today, it's on the brink of yet another first for transportation.
Right behind me, this is the first of its kind mobile carbon capture system, the first ever to be deployed to commercialization anywhere in the world.
Carbon capture is getting a lot of attention in the news lately as a potential solution for climate change. There are two main approaches to capturing carbon. Companies like Climeworks build facilities that suck CO2 out of the air. This is known as direct air capture. Another way is to capture it right at the source before it even enters the air. This is called carbon capture and storage. Remora is taking this approach but making it mobile.
Semi-trucks are one of the very hardest to decarbonize sectors in the US because we rely on semi-trucks to move almost every good that we see around us. And unfortunately, semi-trucks are really, really hard to electrify.
Everyone has been told that electric vehicles are zero emissions. This is the ultimate greenwashing that we're seeing right now. You have to charge them, you have to build them, you have to recycle them, and none of those things are actually figured out or green. And as the vehicle gets bigger, the batteries have to get significantly heavier just to carry their own battery weight. So the efficiencies come down drastically.
Remora believes their solution is the best option for trucks on the roads right now.
We can retrofit onto existing diesel trucks. We don't have to replace every single one of the 2 million trucks on the road in the US. You know, we don't need to overhaul the grid, build out all new charging stations. What's exciting here is that it can start decarbonizing trucks now.
Here's how it works. The device connects to a truck's tailpipe where it conditions the exhaust by removing water and cooling it down. Then, the conditioned exhaust gets pushed through a filter made of zeolite beads, which have microscopic pores where carbon dioxide molecules get physically stuck. Oxygen, nitrogen, and other harmless gases are the wrong size, so they flow right out into the air, leaving the carbon behind. Once the filter is full of carbon, it's heated and pressurized, causing the zeolite pores to release the CO2 molecules. That pure stream of CO2 is compressed into pressure vessels onboard the truck.
The really cool part is that we're using heat from the truck's exhaust to heat up the adsorbent bed, which means that the system is extremely energy efficient, and we have multiple adsorbent beds, so we can capture CO2 in one while we're regenerating another, and then we can switch back and forth.
But turning that science into reality and actually building this mobile carbon capture device from scratch is far from easy.
There you go.
So how many are you guys typically making?
This is our first. The greatest challenge is the fact that nobody makes parts to capture CO2 on a moving vehicle.
The way these beads are distributed is vital to our system. We will definitely need to get to the point where it's not multiple people over multiple days doing this one layer at a time. So a lot of the equipment that we need for our system is not designed for this scale. And absolutely not designed for this application.
If the weld bead is, you know, right here, we'll never get a good seal. Yeah. We're putting ourselves at risk.
Yeah. For some of this equipment, we just know it's never been done before. So a lot of it is very much an iterative process. We learn something, quite often we break something, and then we try again.
In other words, a lot of this is being figured out as they go.
So this motor is actually designed to go on like small propelled airplanes. We had some stuff getting modified, so we're trying to see why or where it broke.
It's a big process to get this device installed on a vehicle.
The device gets installed in a small gap behind the cab.
Most vehicles do have this space, but we have to constantly validate that it will fit, that the weight will get distributed correctly between the axles.
The device doesn't affect cargo space, but at 5,000 pounds, inevitably it lowers fuel efficiency.
So the biggest challenge is really making sure that we're not going to make the vehicle unsafe.
Most of my subsystems are welded underneath this truck and bolted onto the frame, and if any of those fall off, we're in big trouble.
This first device is truly built by hand, so the team must rigorously test it, as some parts are prone to fail.
You can see a bump on the alternator.
Yeah, a little.
Better than you can here. What was that?
The truck turned off, right?
Again? Oh, the truck turned off.
The way the installation works is that we essentially drop the device onto the frame rails and bolt into existing bolt holes that are designed for aftermarket retrofits. Other than that, we install a couple other systems and different parts of the truck. We install a little screen inside the cab, and then we're good to go. One device captures 70-80% of the truck's carbon emissions. That's 200 tons of carbon dioxide every year. And that's just one truck. It's just crazy how big a semi-truck engine is. I think, you know, it's just so different from a car. And you get like 200 tons of CO2 coming out of this engine every year. So it's just, it's a crazy scale that we have to operate at.
A single truck fitted with Remora's device can capture and store up to 1,200 pounds of CO2. Once the tank is full, the device shuts off and exhaust passes through the system as normal until the driver can stop and offload the CO2.
CO2 offloading works by pulling a truck up to a tank just like this. They're a lot bigger at a customer site. It only takes about 15 minutes, and it's the equivalent of reverse fueling. After you connect the truck, the CO2 will be pumped into this tank, stored here, and then we can distribute that to our network of CO2 buyers.
Remora actually owns the CO2 captured by their devices and requires it to be offloaded into their own tanks. Remora then splits any revenue or tax credits from the sale or sequestration of that CO2 with their customers.
The market for CO2 around the world is actually massive. It's a $7.7 billion market, and we are not meeting the world's demand. There are regular shortages of CO2 all around the world. The market is also growing incredibly fast. There are all these cool new companies using CO2 in new ways to produce fuels, laundry detergent, vodka, plastics, you name it. Someone is probably making it out of CO2.
While these innovative uses for CO2 provide sustainable options for sellers, they're a small fraction of the market. One of the largest industrial uses of CO2 is unfortunately a controversial one. Enhanced oil recovery is a process where pressurized CO2 is pumped into existing oil reservoirs where it can push up to 60% more oil than other recovery methods. So for oil and gas companies, it unlocks more oil and more revenue. But Remora says they'll never sell their CO2 for use in oil extraction.
If we can't find someone to utilize the carbon, we will pump the CO2 underground into an EPA-certified well where it's going to be stored for thousands of years. There's lots of monitoring in place to make sure the CO2 is staying put, and this is by far the best way to make sure we're not letting CO2 back into the atmosphere.
While storing captured CO2 underground is the best way to sequester it, it doesn't generate revenue for the owner the same way selling it does. But the federal government does provide a tax credit to incentivize underground sequestration.
So what I tried to do was work backwards from July 26, which is the date that the Allison testing is going to commence. We're going to ship the truck out that day.
Remora says they already have all the needed approvals from the Department of Transportation and the EPA. Ryder, the world's largest trucking company, is Remora's first customer. Their first truck with the device will hit the road in September of 2022. The general model is that Remora sells 10 devices to a company for a pilot. Being the inaugural pilot, Ryder is starting with one device.
We are just getting our first pilot started in the next couple months. Trucking companies are facing a lot of pressure from shippers to find some way to reduce their carbon emissions. So trucking companies are looking at the alternatives, and Remora, in many cases, is the best solution. We retrofit onto their existing trucks. We actually deliver them revenue every year, so the device not only pays for itself, but starts generating a new revenue stream. So this is a really exciting time for mobile carbon capture because there are 2 million semi-trucks in the US, so we've got our work cut out for us. But even just as we get on the thousands of trucks, we're gonna be capturing millions of tons of carbon dioxide every year. It's pretty staggering, the potential impact here.
Is Remora's device merely a stopgap measure to buy us time until battery technology evolves? Whatever happens, it seems their device, if scaled, could have a large impact on decarbonizing regional freight distribution.
We need an all-of-the-above approach. We can't afford to just bet everything on a single silver bullet. We need to develop a lot of different solutions in parallel, and then we can figure out which one's best. One of the single biggest challenges is going to be scaling up our manufacturing operation to meet the demand that we're seeing from fleets.
The biggest challenge with convincing truck companies to use this technology is honestly that they can't order 1,000 of them tomorrow.
The future of carbon capture is modular and repeatable. So what that means is, just like solar panels, you want to build carbon capture that can be churned out of an assembly line over and over again. We're taking carbon capture and shrinking it down so that instead of it being this sprawling construction project, it's this really concentrated manufacturing challenge. And that's how we're going to get carbon capture to be cheap enough to be a really important part of the decarbonization solution.
I've always had the mindset of leaving something like better than you found it. And that's what I'd see that we're doing here. Like, there's a problem. Everybody knows it's a problem. If you're making a company right now, it should be to solve that problem in any way that you can. And the only way we're gonna make a dent in it is if there's hundreds of companies like this one that are all tackling the same huge challenge.
This is where we say, do not try this at home.
I mean, you shouldn't do this at home. Because why would you have a compressor?